So my name is Henry Termeer, and I'm doing the introduction of this meeting today for Hasse Ericson, who is the CEO of the LSF, the Life Science Foundation. This meeting is set up by the Life Science Foundation together with MassBio, and Bob will say a few words. And it is funded, actually, by Biomet Realty. Many of us are living in Biomet Realty. All of us know MassBio. Some of you may not know the Life Science Foundation. Two words on that. This is an interesting group that would be good to become familiar with, because we're trying to capture what's happening in this industry, and to capture it in a way so that it becomes part of something we have in a very serious way, working with serious libraries, working with serious people, writing serious articles. One of the writers is here in the room, Mark Jones. We do this because this is an industry that has a very big ambition. We mean to change the world. We mean our ambition to change our ambition about health, about broadly life sciences. And I don't think anybody engaged in this field, whether they are in academia or in companies, feels that this is immodest to want to change the world. But it is a big deal. It's a very big ambition, because every human being will be impacted by what happens in this industry. I've been in it now for almost 40 years, an unbelievable amount of time. I've seen such an incredible story develop over those 40 years. And today we talk about one aspect of that story, and that's patient advocacy. There is a remarkable amount of energy, absolutely unstoppable and unchangeable, coming from patients. We are getting two things to come together that will not change. The life science part, the health part of life science, is all about creating health. It's all about patients. It has always been about patients. But for the most part, these were treatments on a shelf, anonymous. Increasingly, science makes it possible to make it much more personal, much more direct. Now we look the patient in the eye, and the patient will be demanding. The patient will say, I will have treatment. And the parents and the family will say, we need treatments when treatments become available. And that knowledge is occurring in a very natural way. We are forcing companies to publish everything about clinical trials. So patients know about it way ahead of the curve. We see what's currently happening in Duchenne's. It's massive what happens around Duchenne's. It is another story. Maybe it comes up in this meeting. It's an unstoppable thing. So today we talk about patient advocacy, not to say we've now talked about it and we move on to the next subject. This is a subject that will stay with us. And to the extent that we have an opportunity, we will have many opportunities to continue to learn about this, I think it will benefit us enormously. It is an absolutely inevitable movement that I think we can truly support and have to support and have to spend time on supporting. So Bob, you want to say a word? Or shall we move straight into the conference? Bob is MassBio, and he is the other side of this meeting. Come, stand up.
No, thank you, Henry. Thank you very much. Bob Coughlin, the CEO of MassBio. It's an honor to be here, and it's an honor to partner with the Life Science Foundation. And Henry, I want to thank you. We all know in this room how much of a pioneer you are in this industry, and most importantly, what you have done in the role of patient advocacy with your company and your history and your future moving forward. Henry was one of the people that encouraged me to leave government to work in this industry, folks like Henry and Josh Boger, and I think while I was in government, I got to meet John Maraganore and people like David Meeker and so many, but the real reason my interest came into this industry was through relationships that I've had with people like Joan Finnegan Brooks, who's on the panel, and my involvement with the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. You know, I have an 11-year-old son that has CF, and I've been a patient advocate for so long in that area, and it's an honor for me to actually have a full-time job in this space, and I'm so excited to hear from this panel because I feel that patient advocacy is what it's all about, and all of our member companies at Mass Bio and all the history that the Life Science Foundation will be covering on industry's behalf will always come back to the most important thing in the equation of all of our businesses, and it's the customer. And who is the customer? The customer is the patient. That's why we all do what we do. So thank you, Henry. With that being said, I want to thank Biomed Realty as well, and I want to thank our partners at the Life Science Foundation. And I'm going to pass it off to Dr. David Meeker to start the panel.
Great. So thank you, Henry, and thank you, Bob. Welcome, everybody. I think we have a great panel here and an interesting topic. There's a number, or many, I think, panels, discussions around the role of patient advocacy. So at the one level, this is not new. I think we're going to get into some of the issues that are certainly topical and are discussed in these other panels. But there's another twist to this, which is the history and the emphasis on the history of patient advocacy and how it informs where we are today and where do we want to go. And I do think there's some interesting lessons to be learned that this panel is going to flesh out for us. So what I'm going to do is ask each member of the panel to take 2 minutes to introduce themselves. I think that's sometimes more interesting than having me read their bios to them, because hopefully they'll highlight what they think is of most interest about their participation today, but connecting that also to their interest in patient advocacy, either through the industry or otherwise. So just to run down their titles as we go down. So John Maraganore, who's CEO of Alnylam. Bill Haseltine, who is a professor, founder, chair of two academic research departments at Harvard Medical School, and also a founder of Human Genome Sciences, so Biotech. Joan Finnegan Brooks, who is the founder of Patient-Focused Market Research. And Phil Brown, who directs the Social Science Environmental Health Research Institute at Northeastern University. So with those brief intros, I'll now turn over to John. And
just say a few things about my experiences in the context of this discussion. I mean, I've been in the biotech industry now for 27, 28 years, mostly in the Kendall Square area over the years, just have gone to different parking lots over that period of time for the most part, which is just a wonderful thing to think about, just how this community has evolved. And at Biogen, was involved in a number of programs, including the MS program at Biogen, where clearly in those early days when Avonex was first approved, we began to outreach and understand what was important from a patient community standpoint. And obviously that product was very successful in its ultimate approval. And Millennium was involved very actively in Velcade and working with the Myeloma Foundation and how Velcade ultimately got to the market as a product. Also was involved with a drug called Campath, which got approved for CLL. I'll come back to that in just a minute. And then at Alnylam, have been very focused on RNA interference therapies, and we've been focusing very much on genetic disease, genetic medicines, if you will, with a very strong focus on the orphan disease space. But the comment I'll make about Campath for just a moment with Henry and David here is that it was a drug I helped get approved. My mother had CLL, and it's a rare opportunity to be involved in a drug's approval, but then to actually be involved in the use of that drug in somebody you deeply care for, and that was an experience that I had, and it helped her prolong her life. Of course, she ultimately succumbed, but it's amazing that many of us get to touch medicines that not only are important for patient groups, but also are important for people that we love and care for.
That's great. Phil?
So I've been studying patient movements, health social movements for a long time. I began many years ago by studying mental patients' rights activists and their interaction with clinical psychiatry and psychology, as well as government, particularly departments of mental health. And in the middle of that period of research, I found myself 2-year research leave in a forensic psychiatry unit at a psychiatric hospital. And one of my colleagues there was studying people in Woburn for the childhood leukemia cluster that some of you may know about, most famous for the film and book, A Civil Action, but about which I also wrote a book, and turned my attention to environmental health activists and the role of people in the environmental health movements to work together to clean up hazardous waste sites, to affect government policy. And I've also studied lots of different health groups in asthma, Gulf War illnesses, and breast cancer, looking at their interaction with life scientists, with other advocates, and with government agencies. So it's all kind of brought me here today to think about the thing we're talking about today. But basically, everything you could think of about the history and policy around health social movements.
John.
I've consulted with organizations involved in cystic fibrosis care and research for over 25 years, helping them integrate patient and family perspectives into their strategic decisions for the cystic fibrosis marketplace. I was born into patient advocacy and the CF Foundation. My parents were among early volunteers in 1955 at the creation of the foundation. I've lost two siblings to cystic fibrosis, one in the 1950s at age 2, one in the 1960s at age 15, and I myself, on a daily basis, deal with the challenges of cystic fibrosis. I've been a leader and active participant in the CF Foundation's many projects and initiatives, from clinical practice guidelines on different aspects of patient care, adult care, patient engagement and adherence, which is a continuing problem for our community, patient access, quality improvement efforts in our specialized CF care center network around the country, and certainly clinical research protocol review and increasing participation among our families and participants, people with CF. Advocacy for and involvement in the cystic fibrosis community is certainly my life's work and my passion, and I'm very, very honored to be among this distinguished panel here.
John, Bill.
Well, I too feel honored to be in this on this panel. I'm particularly grateful to Biogen. My son has MS, and he's been one of the longest patients on Tysabri. And I can clearly remember the time before and after that drug, and so I'm especially grateful to you. I've had a long and varied career in health research, biotechnology, and throughout that career, I've had multiple interactions with patient advocacy groups. I've been part of patient advocacy groups as a member of the board of the American Cancer Society, the Leukemia Society, and AMFAR, and those are groups that all act, are active for their patient constituencies. As a scientist, I've interacted working to lobby Congress to pay more attention to HIV/AIDS. Now, that was as a scientist, but it was on behalf of a patient advocacy group. Later, as a member of the NIAID Council, National Institutes of Allergy and Infectious Disease, through which most of the money flows for AIDS research. In the early days, we worked very closely, eventually I should say, worked very closely with the AIDS activist community to structure clinical trials, to help work with the FDA on accelerated approval. It started out a very, very rocky interaction, and it ended up as a very productive, and I think transformative interaction. And then, as the CEO of Human Genome Sciences, developing a drug for lupus, we had to blaze a new trail for how to test the drug for lupus. No drug had ever been approved, so there was no clinical pathway. So we worked very closely with the patient advocacy groups, with the FDA, and helped create a pathway which we followed, and hopefully now many others will follow. So I've seen throughout my entire career the importance of patient advocacy groups in both the scientific, budgetary, and approval process of new pharmaceuticals.
So, qualified panel, and I think just an initial observation, Bob mentioned it when he started off, just how incredibly personal healthcare is, right? I mean, no matter where we sit, you may be quite disconnected from an organizational sense, but we all, of course, from a personal level, connect quite deeply. So to start, Bill, we have our historical, you're the historian on the panel, and do you want to provide us with a little bit of context for your thoughts on patient advocacy and how it evolved over time?
So as a sociologist, I often think that much of social change comes about because social movements push for it. And in our history, we see that with certainly mental patients activists. This was also enshrined in some important acts. The Community Mental Health Centers Acts of 63 and 65 were probably the first place that the federal government required patient participation in advisory boards for community mental health centers. And it was a real trailblazing kind of thing to do because that was a very unheard of thing before. There were a lot of important reform movements that patients had committed themselves to. Most importantly, and something which I think affects all of us, the women's health movement was a very powerful thing beginning in the late 60s, early 70s. Much of what we now take for granted in terms of routine women's health care, in terms of OBGYN visits, in terms of childbirth, alternative birthing centers, various reproductive rights. These are all things that came out of patient advocacy. They sometimes were dealing with individual providers as doctor-patient interaction. Sometimes they were with hospitals. Sometimes they were with state and federal governments. So really a lot of the things that we have seen that have helped us and that we take for granted were of that sort. I won't say much about AIDS because we have an expert, somebody who's worked with AMFAR, but for many people in my field, when we think about patient activism, we look at the impact of AIDS activists in the clinical trials and really in reshaping the way that the FDA and a lot of scientists thought about the importance of patients. We also saw in the patients' rights movement in the mental health field, not just criticism of professional and institutional treatment, but alternative institutions. So a lot of patients' rights groups were so effective at alternative care. I remember visiting years ago a group called the Mental Patients Association in Vancouver back in the mid-70s. And they had set up two drop-in centers, a residential center, and a farm. And they were so effective at providing alternative care that the main university hospital, UBC, had the major psychiatric ward in the area, actually hired them to come and do triage to prevent people from being admitted to the inpatient unit because they understood that the Mental Patients Association had very good alternative care. So it wasn't just criticism from the outside, but really participation. And much like what we saw with the AIDS activists, too. Some years later, when I began to study what I called contested illnesses, where there were disputes about the effect of environmental causes, the breast cancer movement really stood out as a movement in which women played a very important role, men too, but mainly women, mainly people who had breast cancer or had it in their families, and they began to provide alternative approaches. So ways of providing support groups, ways of seeking financial support for alternative investigations, particularly into the environmental factors behind breast cancer. And again, successes sometimes at the federal level. The Department of Defense took a very important direction when it said, we're going to have these breast cancer activists sit on the review panels, and they're going to help us distribute federal funds for breast cancer research, because they know. The National Breast Cancer Coalition, through its project LEAD, began to train its advocates to be competent to sit on these panels. The California Breast Cancer Research Program followed suit some years later. And so we see also the role of patient advocacy in that sense, too, of helping to shape the scientific deliberations that fund research that's important to us. I get a lot of my funding through the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, and they too were pioneers. They saw themselves as really groundbreaking in terms of bringing patients, in this sense, let us not say clinical patients, but activists who were part of environmental justice communities, environmental health organizations, onto the review panels to help them distribute money through some of their very groundbreaking programs that the director at the time Ken Olden was putting forth. So what I see in this history is not a history just of struggle, complaint, disputation, but of alternative treatment forms, of collaborations, and of changes in the very nature of the scientific apparatus, from the review process to the authorship of articles together, and a sense that there can be great amounts of collaboration. So this is what the patients' movements have given us. And some of you may be familiar most recently in our own fair city of Boston, the Open Notes program, where patients are given access to their notes. And this is a wonderful program that originally was seen as very groundbreaking, and you'll never get doctors to agree to that. And very quickly, lots of physicians signed on to this. And it's been one of those other examples quite recently in our local history we could be very proud of, because what we understand in the world of science and in medicine is that the affected people are the ones who often can tell us what the disease feels like, what kinds of mobilization would help to get people out there, and also helps to break down some of the barriers between patient groups, activist groups, government, and industry. I've often found myself as a broker. I've worked together with organizations, particularly state governments. I've worked with agencies where they were being sued by an environmental group in the community, and I had to be the broker in between them because they were both my partners. So these are some of the lessons I think that the patients' movements, the advocacy movements, tell us, that there are ways to dispute, to contest, but also to heal, to collaborate.
So, Bill, you were in the middle of the AIDS activism, which is certainly, if not the earliest, one of the more memorable examples of patient advocacy. And so just a little bit of history, what was it like, and then lessons learned from that? And
well, I had a multiple perspective view of that. First of all, I was a scientist working on the problem. We were some of the very first scientists to try to understand the virus and try to develop diagnostic tests, therapeutics, and approaches. And one of the first problems we had was there was no money to do that. And so I worked with AMFAR to help them in a, I think, a pretty tense standoff at one point. We convinced AMFAR that the focus should be on supporting scientists who had no background in AIDS, because nobody had a background in AIDS, to get involved, and we created a rapid grants program. Really, I have to confess, was an adaptation of a leukemia society program just to get scientists involved. But then there was no budget. You have to go back to those days to realize AIDS was not popular. It was the Reagan years. There were Mormons in control of the HHS and CDC, and they just were not prepared. And the recommended budget for the 85, I think, was $1 million for NIH research. Rock Hudson got sick, and that's my opportunity. I became an activist myself, and it was sort of fun to do, because Elizabeth Taylor and I and one lobbyist went to Congress, and in one supplemental appropriation, working with Ted Stevens and Ted Kennedy and Henry Waxman, we got $362 million. There's a side story, which is because we got about $30 million from the Defense Department. That triggered the women's movement to get money from the Defense Department for breast cancer. Yes. You're giving it to guys, give it to us too. And so it was a funny echo with what you had just said. Then, looking at it from yet another, let me say two other things we did that I think were really effective, or one thing. That is, we got Princess Diana to hug an AIDS patient in a hospital, and many of you may remember that scene. And we got her to pick up an AIDS baby. Now, I can't say we got her to do that. She did it, of course. But we worked with her through a foundation of AIDS activists in London who were her friends through, actually, the ballet to convince her to do that, to try to destigmatize. And I think that single act was the most important act I know of in destigmatizing the issue of AIDS. And so we were directly involved in some of those things. Sitting on the council of NIAID was quite an experience. These days, if you gave a talk at an AIDS conference, you might have blood poured over you. Some of my friends did, by AIDS activists. Certainly, you were subject to a lot of pressure, let's say, from the community. And that recent film, the Dallas Buyer Club, gives you a realistic feel for what those days were like. There was a desperation, and a real desperation, because people were dying. People's best friends were dying. They were dying. They were desperate to get medicine. And the gay community at that time, I think, really believed that science was against them, that the government was against them. And they were right in some part. They weren't entirely wrong. The scientists, we were not against them. We were on their side. And it took a long time for them to understand that. I think for me, and we were interacting with them, both positively and negatively. The key event I remember was Compound Q. I don't know how many people remember Compound Q, but the AIDS activist community was convinced, in the movie it was peptide T. Okay, that was another drug that really wasn't working, but it was Compound Q that really changed that interaction. And what had happened is a group of activists had found Compound Q, thought it was going to, it was a Chinese extract of a natural product, thought it was going to cure AIDS, decided against our advice to do their own trial, and quickly realized they'd made a mistake when almost everybody on that drug died within a few weeks. And that was a sobering experience. It was a wake-up call. And after that, they were willing to come in and sit down with us, as you've described, on many of the deliberations, particularly on that group at NIAID that was trying to lay out the program for how to conduct and run clinical trials. And they became very helpful. More than helpful, they were creative and innovative and forceful in changing the way drugs can get approved. Rapid approval process at NIH, at the FDA, was largely as a result of their effort. The use of surrogate markers, viral load, was a key contribution that some of the scientists pushed for, but we didn't have the power to do it. We wanted to do it, the pharmaceutical industry wanted to do it, but it was really the gay community and the activist community that was very powerful, making sure that all the congressmen understood what the issues were, and eventually getting the FDA to change some very fundamental procedures, which are in place today. Not for all diseases. Perhaps there should be more activity. And that still stands, I think, as a signal achievement for how a well-organized group can change fundamental processes, can improve the way research is done, can help pharmaceutical companies design and implement clinical trials, and can alter the way the FDA itself views drug approval.
Great. So we'll come back to that experience in a minute. So Joan, having grown up in the CF community and obviously close to the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation and what it's done, it's often held up as the role model from a patient organization alike. So your experience as a patient being part of that organization, as a professional observer of that organization that, as I said, many other groups aspire to be, just some reflections on that world, pros and cons, if you will,
sure.
Of that.
Cystic fibrosis, unlike other diseases, has got a very, very small population. And we, too, have felt that we've needed to forge our own way and create a pathway for approval. We really didn't have any drugs that were specifically approved for cystic fibrosis prior to the 1990s. So putting in place clinical trial network that we have across the country and really, I think the signature of the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation is when we decided in Bob Bell, the leader of our organization, was really not very satisfied, nor was anyone else. These were desperate times when people were losing their children in childhood. You were considered old in your teens. And not being totally happy with the discovery of the gene in 1989 didn't really yield the kind of clinical improvement that we'd hoped. And of course, Big Pharma at the time was very much focused on big blockbuster drugs and not really looking at small indications where there would be no payoff. And so Bob Bell and the foundation board of directors pioneered the venture philanthropy model, where the foundation has really gone to raise money and mitigate the risk that small companies have in getting started with CF research, and was able to do that early on to spur interest in the disease and creating molecules and drugs that would attack the defect. Because at that point, we knew what the gene was, and we knew what the protein it made was, and we knew what the mutations were, but we really didn't have an effective treatment. And from that approach, we've seen tremendous successes. Vertex, in our own backyard, the approval of the drug Kalydeco is really the first drug to come out of that, if you will, that venture philanthropy model, and has really been a game changer for the 4% of the people with a specific kind of mutation for CF. And from that, we've really adopted that model. And as you mentioned, David, it's, the CF Foundation in that model is often held as the way to do this for orphan diseases. And I know as a observer and as a participant, the fact that we have this network and we've created it, and we've really been very accomplished in getting all of our constituencies together and singularly focused on goal has been a real joy to witness because we have things that are cranking out at the other end that have really had significant impact on patient care. Certainly, Kalydeco is one end of the spectrum where it really changes the disease from a cellular level. But even prior to that, some of the successes we had in the 90s and in 2000s to allow people to age with more lung function maintenance programs, and that's been a real signature event of my lifetime for sure.
That's great. So John, creating a company, looking to transform any number of diseases here, not just working with one patient group, but aspiring to treat many. How do you think about that as you have this long list of things you need to do to be successful? Where does the patient interaction fit in that equation, and how do you do it?
Yeah, it's critical. I mean, I'll give one example, speaking of the CF Foundation and Joan's comments. I mean, early on, as we were trying to identify opportunities for our technology, one opportunity was in the space of CF and trying to find ways to rescue CFTR in the lung, and it was a somewhat risky proposition and certainly a long lead time to really get to the right results. We probably wouldn't have done it had it not been for the CF Foundation, who bought into that vision and contributed a multi-million dollar grant to basically explore that type of opportunity. Now, that one didn't pan out, but there are many other examples like that, like what they did with Vertex, that ultimately did pan out. So the availability of risk capital in some entrepreneurial, you know, scientifically solid foundation, but in a more entrepreneurial manner, and what the CF Foundation has done is a great example of that in terms of what we've done at Alnylam. But more recently, David, it's been around programs that we are advancing based on an interest in obviously making a difference in these patients' lives, connecting very early on with patient groups as it relates, for example, in our patisiran program, which is now in phase 3, we're working closely with the Amyloidosis Foundation in the U.S. and also relevant foundations in Europe to really identify patients in our phase 3 trial, to really use those foundations, a relationship that we've built over now 3-4 years as we've been developing this program, but to help us get the word out around our drug, what it could do, and use that framework as a way of building relationships, building a connection to patients in a way that's based on trust and obviously the promise of the medicines that we're aiming to deliver for them, but as a mechanism to help us accrue patients into trials as one mechanism. And of course, there are many, many other benefits that we see in these foundations. We have a program in porphyria, which is an ultra-orphan disorder, where we've been touched by the impassioned efforts of a patient group, the American Porphyria Foundation, who have really driven our connection with KOLs, our connection with, you know, centers globally, where we can do studies that would ultimately allow us to understand the natural history of the disease, but also think about endpoints that we would use in clinical studies. So it really has touched multiple dimensions of what we do as a company. And I think without that support system in place, it'd be hard to imagine doing studies in many of these orphan diseases. And I think these foundations are really critical as part of it overall.
So both Bill and you highlighted the enabling role that the patient organization can play. You want to talk a little bit about the internal, how the internal environment is impacted by connecting early with these, and I'm thinking about developing a culture and, you know, in terms of what, you know, how does that play in your thought process building a company?
Well, when we were, we came to the lupus drug by a systematic process that really wasn't connected to the patient community. We were studying secreted proteins, what they might do, how they affected B cells. We thought at first we were going to cause them to proliferate. Then we thought we were going to use them to treat multiple myeloma. And one of our scientists pointed out, well, maybe if we antagonize them, it will calm down some autoimmune diseases. And we did some studies and showed that. However, once we were on that track, we were in the wilderness because there was no FDA approval. And I know you know what that feels like. Right? And you really have to understand the disease. You have to work with the doctors. Most of all, you have to work with the patients. And they're very well-organized advocacy groups. There are two big lupus foundations and a number of smaller ones. And we very early on made a connection. And I have to say it was nothing but a positive experience with the FDA and with these patient advocacy groups. Because without that interaction, without the patients helping us, that their advocacy groups and the very talented people like my fellow panelists on the right who understand the disease, but understand much more than the disease. They understand through years of experience the regulatory pathways, the interactions with the FDAs, what the doctors can do, what they can't do, how to recruit patients. All of that was critical. We, anybody who's been familiar with trying to create a new pathway knows it's a long and involved process. We had to have three public hearings across the country. The patient advocacy groups were vital to those. They were there with us at every one of those meetings. And in the end, I think about 90% of our joint recommendations to the FDA were approved in the final pathway. And it was really that pathway that was critical because without an agreed upon series of endpoints, you're in the dark. You don't know what you're measuring and you don't know what is needed for approval. And all of that was done together with the patient advocacy groups, without which we would never have had a drug.
So it was a wonderful positive experience.
Yeah.
From inside the company.
You know, one side of this too, from an internal perspective, and we're simply students of what you and Henry did, so we're not gonna lay any claim to this. But the ability to bring patients into the company at the right time, or leaders of foundations to talk about the patient experience is unbelievably impactful for employees and for what we do. We just had a company meeting last week, all company meeting, and the most impactful presentation was one by one of our MSLs who really has been out touching the patients themselves, working with patient groups, and that was the most inspiring aspect of the entire, you know, meeting. And it's because it's what connects everybody in a company to what they do and why they do it. And that part of the connection of the company with a patient group is something which is incredibly important in motivating, inspiring, getting people to work hard in a very focused, dedicated way. It's certainly transformed our company. I'm sure others have that experience as well.
So, Joan, as a patient, your experience in that realm? Or?
I absolutely, sort of from the other perspective, it's wonderful. We've made a habit in the CF Foundation. We have a big national event, Great Strides, in May, and we've gotten practically everyone in the room, if we can, to walk with us and to really engage companies in the common goal that we all have. And it's so meaningful for families to see corporate company presence at these kind of initiatives because you feel most of the time that you're slugging it out day by day, living alone and really isolated and fighting the disease. And when you see John come to an event, you don't feel so alone. And you know that there are other resources behind him and the multitude of companies that we have. And to your point, John, it really engages both the employee to the company as well as the community to the company, and that just only has positive things. In fact, I can remember, I mean, back in my day, there were no companies that were making drugs for CF, and I've been privileged to witness that great change. But I remember going to a medical conference for cystic fibrosis, and I think the only vendor in the room was Genentech. And I remember going up to all of the people at the booth, the accountant, the salesperson, and thanking them for the profound effect that drug that they developed, Pulmozyme, had on my community, on me and their community. And I think a lot of them were looking like, well, I have no idea what you mean, but it was a really meaningful moment to be able to thank the people who have worked so hard and dedicated so much. So it's a two-way street, and we appreciate it as well.
That's great. So it's an obvious point. I don't want to lose it, right? I mean, we working in the healthcare field is such a powerful element, and how we think about it, how we harness it, wherever we sit in the stakeholder world, it's useful not to lose sight of. So I want to go to a question for everybody here, and it's around the tension or the dynamic. So certainly in the AIDS world, the patients feeling that the world was not moving fast enough. Regulators were not moving fast enough. Companies were not moving fast enough. Government was not moving fast enough. Companies wanting to move quickly, but needing to go through a process. The film that Bill mentioned, which is worth seeing, certainly captured that, right? There is a legitimate argument that says you need to do the trials. And there's value to doing the trials for the greater good. So I just want to hear thoughts on, you know, that tension that comes in, compassionate use. There's a hint of efficacy. It's incomplete. Does somebody get the drug? What role does FDA play? So there's a lot of permutations here, but how does a group of parties that should be natural collaborators but often end up at polar opposites on opposite sides of the table, you know, resolve and work through some of that?
Well, you know, one thing, David, that I think is interesting is obviously the FDA, as part of FDASIA, has made a commitment to really engage patient communities as part of the dialogue around endpoints, and really harkens back to what happened during HIV. And I think that is going to be very interesting to see how that ultimately plays out. It's just beginning, I think it's fair to say, but the whole spirit and sentiment of a patient engagement around endpoints and risk-benefit frameworks, I think, can be very helpful for drug developers and regulators and patients to really have that type of dialogue around how does it all fit together? What are the endpoints that a patient community would say are meaningful to them? What level of risk-benefit, what standard, what evidentiary standard, are given the condition they live in, are they willing to accept? Based on, you know, how much safety, how much efficacy. I think that can be very impactful. And I think it's still very, very early to see where that's going. But I think that it could be, hopefully it's a type of positive impact it had on HIV. If we can see that in other disease settings, I think it could be very powerful as an approach.
Well, I would say that, as you pointed out, the interaction can have multiple components to it. And with the early AIDS interactions, there was tremendous hostility because the patient groups, the activist community, really didn't feel that either the scientific community or the medical community was on their side. And I remember the first clinical trial from AZT. The activist community line on that was, of the 36 people who needed the drug immediately, 18 were deliberately left untreated. That's a chilling line. And it was true. There were 18 people deliberately left untreated. And the community at that time did not understand it. They came to understand why this situation is as it is. They thought that there was a secret cabinet of medicines that the government and pharmaceutical companies had that was not unlocked. They came to realize the cupboard was bare and we needed their help to develop the drugs. But there's a broader point, I think, that you've raised with this question, which is it's really important to have educated, experienced, knowledgeable patient activists. That it's a responsibility of those people, those of us who are working on the disease, those doctors, those scientists, those pharmaceutical companies, to help educate and work in a very positive way to make sure that the patient advocates are as well informed as they can be of what we have to admit is a labyrinth to negotiate. It is not simple to conceive, it's not simple to describe, and it is certainly not simple to navigate and get to the other end of that labyrinth. And I think it's that interaction, very positive, long-term. So AIDS was a little bit unique because it was a new disease that just burst on the scene in a very particular way. But if you look at many of the diseases, cystic fibrosis, a whole variety of cancers, diabetes, kidney disease, mental health, which I think is still an area that needs a lot more. It's not, you know, the mental health that you raised, I think, is a really important issue because a lot of those patients can't advocate for themselves, and it's a really issue. I'd like to hear a little more about the patient advocacy groups for those.
Stigma is very important both for AIDS and for mental health. Now, actually, a lot of mental health patients were able to advocate. I was very surprised to find that people with developmental disabilities had a harder time advocating, and usually it was their family and friends who did mm-hmm. it. But the stigma of those diseases, and I saw it even more recently with military personnel coming back and not being taken seriously for Gulf War illnesses, and how difficult that was, because that too is a stigma. I'm supposed to be a strong soldier defending my country, and I come back with these very weird, unexplainable symptoms of weakness and fatigue, and I can't work anymore. So these are all kinds of fatigue, of stigma. And it comes out, so my experience is more in, you know, the treatment areas and the disputes about environmental factors. It's not about the drug discovery part. But with AIDS, you know, you really have an interesting picture here. Years ago, I was on the advisory committee of a panel that was funded by Robert Wood Johnson Foundation to look at alternative treatment forms, because a lot of physicians were so seeing, you know, AIDS as a stigmatized disease that they wouldn't treat AIDS patients. And those that didn't really support them in the way they wanted to be. So there were a lot of alternative clinics in many cities around the country. And Robert Wood Johnson Foundation said, you know what, those places, there's so many of them, they're treating so many people, we should study them. Because previously they had studied this national hospice project in which they had actually provided the evidence that was then used by Medicare to support hospice payments. So they said, well, let's look at that for AIDS too. And they found that indeed these community-based providers were more efficient than many of the formal medical ones. And again, they had to overcome stigma at the physician's level, at the hospital level, and at the foundation level too.
Just to add one thing on the patient advocacy side, if you're suffering or your child is suffering from any kind of disease, tomorrow isn't good enough. It has to be today. And one of the things that I think galvanized our community several years ago was looking at the number of clinical trials that would require patient participation 10 years ago and sort of projecting out what we thought we would need for patient participation and realizing that we were not going to make that goal. And one of the reasons was any patient who was on any kind of government program, whether SSI or SSDI, would often get disqualified from those healthcare benefits if they participated in clinical research because of the income. And in 2010, it was probably the only bipartisan act in the Congress at that time, but it got signed into law, and it's called IACT, and it stands for Improving Access to Clinical Trials through allowing an exception of compensation for clinical research participation to not bounce people off. And for us, it opened up nearly, actually more than 50% of our population who could then consider participating in trials. And that really has been a major component piece of our success in recruiting quickly. And of course, you know, as a company, you want it to be recruited quickly and at the least cost possible, and approval quickly as well. And we've been very good at doing that. And that was a pivotal moment where advocates said, this is what we can do to open up that gateway. And it's been effective for us.
That reminds me of I think a number of us have made, which is the importance of patient advocacy groups in clinical trial enrollment. That's a very big deal. Let me point out where it hasn't been so successful. About the same number of men have prostate cancer as women have breast cancer. Yet the number of men in clinical trials for prostate cancer is less than a tenth that for women. And that's an example where an advocacy group might make some powerful inroads. Men are a lot more resistant to signing up for these clinical trials, but it's an area that needs more work. So we're in no means done with the role. And let me point out one other area that I think is going to be determinative for our future, and that is the elderly and the chronically ill. If you look forward and look at what society is going to be 30 or 40 years from now, this big bulge of elderly is entering the healthcare system. And not all, many of them have no morbidities, but many of them also have multiple morbidities. And how are we going to deal with that? Will they be a patient advocacy group? How do they organize when it's not one disease? It's different diseases in multiple diseases, but spread in a very peculiar pattern. I think that's something that we have to think about if we go forward, and that's going to be a major focus of the pharmaceutical and healthcare industry. But what organization is going to do it? Will it be the cancer? Will it be the diabetes? Will it be the Alzheimer's? Which one is going to put all of those together to help deal with these multiple morbidities? So there's, I think, many big issues in the future to think about the importance of patient advocacy groups.
That you mentioned breast cancer and prostate cancer, because many of us will remember there was a time that no one talked about cancer at all, and certainly not about breast cancer. And then we had some important public figures go public with their breast cancer. We had the support groups, a kind of social movement approach to it. But all of a sudden, breast cancer was something everybody could talk about and wanted to, because they knew that to share this would enable other people, empower them, make them not feel alone. And I remember at the time, many people were saying, this is great, this activism. I bet men will never do the same for prostate cancer. And so it turned out, though, that there were some groups that began to mobilize to at least talk about it. And of course, it's not the same. And you're right, the numbers in the trials are very low. But I'm saying I have faith that the most stigmatized things are now natural to us to hear and talk about. And that will come, too.
So, Phil, the critical elements to creating a patient voice. So, you know, it's back to this question of, it's not just, you know, putting up a charter and forming an organization. It's what are the critical elements to having a meaningful voice in the equation? So, the breast cancer has a meaningful voice, the prostate cancer groups perhaps less so, and the Alzheimer groups in the future, or diabetes, you know, more diffuse. And again, so what is it that's required to become relevant, to become a meaningful voice?
Well, I think I mentioned support groups. So that was something that people learned in the women's movement in general, that consciousness-raising groups had provided that vehicle. And so when people started to think about breast cancer activism, that was one of the things that started, supporting other people with breast cancer. So you have to be able to provide a critique of what's existing. You have to provide some alternative services. You have to have some vision for the future. And hopefully even be able to collaborate on research. I mentioned before, under Ken Olden's leadership, the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, they brought community groups onto the research process and formed academic community partnerships, which has now really taken off and is spread through many other institutes of NIH as well, and through Kellogg and Ford and a number of foundations. So I think the sense of being able to do the research yourself and to show that you have knowledge. I mentioned before that National Breast Cancer Coalition has Project Lead, where they train people to be on review panels. I work a lot for the last 10 or 12 years with Silent Spring Institute in Newton, Massachusetts. They do a lot of their own research on endocrine disruptors and their relationship to breast cancer. That kind of research done sometimes by small groups that are mission-driven science groups often are important. And then sympathetic scientists are important, sympathetic professionals, and sympathetic people at federal and state agencies. So were it not for Ken Olden as the first person heading an NIH institute to take on that community-based approach, we wouldn't have gotten that far. So it's a group, a cadre of visionary people at each level who can then talk to each other, who can assemble together.
Do you need it?
Element that that's necessary, and that is, let's take a look at what clinical trials were before and after the women's movement. Clinical trials explicitly excluded women, okay? And so what was the key determinant there? Well, it wasn't a group of women with breast cancer or any particular disease. It was women saying, we need our rights. So it was a social movement that you have studied, but it was a social movement that then focused on one very important critical element, which is better include us. The same is should be true now for the elder community. They are explicitly excluded. There's a cutoff. If you're older than this age, you're not going to be in the clinical trial. Well, does that make sense when a lot of people with those diseases are going to be older? I don't think so. So I think there has to be a social movement that underlies the activism. With the gay community, it was there. And with the breast cancer trials and now including women in trials, it was there. But I think that is one element that may be overlooked, which is the whole social impetus that mobilizes individuals to focus on particular areas.
So, a little further, the role of emotion versus professionalism. Okay, you talked about the value of having knowledgeable patient advocates on the other side. On the other hand, the role of raw emotion, as you said, the mother with a child, tomorrow is too late.
Well, let's talk about compassionate use in that context. I think many of us saw the Josh Hardy situation as related to a child with leukemia that had adenoviral infection, where literally over the course of days, a mother, rightfully, trying to get access to a medicine that could be life-saving for that child, and social media leading to a situation where a company was barraged without the evidence that ideally you'd like to have about a medicine being used in a compassionate setting. And then some very difficult decisions having to be made about, do you provide compassionate use? Do you set it up through a protocol? How does one do that? Do you help the one or think about how you develop your medicine for the many? These are very complicated features. And I think the whole aspect of emotion combined now with social media is a whole new dimension on this that's going to affect our world in terms of how we do clinical studies.
I'm glad you mentioned social media. I have been in a number of meetings now with the Pink Army group, and some of you may know it, some of you may not, but I suggest you look at it, because it may be a powerful determinant of all of the future of how clinical trials are done. The Pink Army's philosophy, as far as I can understand, is that we are going to organize our own clinical trials. We're going to find the patient groups that are affected. We're going to go online, we're going to reach out for them, and we are going to design and implement our own clinical trials, whether it's for personalized medicines or for specific pathways. And whether that particular movement is successful or not, it does represent a sea change in the way that I think the pharmaceutical industry, the biotech industry, will look at clinical trials. Very interesting, and I would say quantitative departure, it's a qualitative departure from the way we've looked at clinical trials in the past. I don't know if any of you have interacted with the Pink Army people, but it's a...
There's a group called the Army of Women, which is a large number of people who put their medical information online as a database, so that if people are going to study a particular variant, they can contact them and say, can we include you? Something similar, the Personal Genome Project is another example where lots of people are volunteering their genomes. George Church at Harvard founded this. And again, it's the kind of thing where it's an open access database that people can go grab this information and use it for research and drug development. So I think this is part of a larger thing about citizen science that's become hugely important for our country. And whether it's ornithology or astronomy or medical research, that kind of citizen science has become real big. In my field, in the environmental health field, there are tons of people doing low-cost community monitoring all over and crowdsourcing that information. So I think we've got to be open, and a lot of that is progressing through social media.
Right, and I think the whole role of social media in patient advocacy is something that's an emergent phenomenon that is going to change the landscape.
Absolutely. I think I think one of the things that social media has done for the smaller community is it really allows, obviously, instead of a command central push out information, we now can hear what's going on, and we serve in a different role where things are much more immediately brought to our attention. And as a foundation, as an advocacy group, we were able to facilitate discussion and circulate issues around. And I think on the fundraising side for again, a small group, it has just leveraged all of the people that we can gather to the mission. So we have more than five times the number of people on our Facebook friends. So it's just a reach that we wouldn't have, and I think that changes. And frankly, you find out all sorts of different avenues of social media popping up to serve the community needs, patient to patient, or mom to mom, or adult to adult, and that's been really very helpful in knitting the community together.
So we have about 15 minutes left. We're going to open it up now for a bigger conversation, invite questions from the audience here. You have many places we can go, which we haven't gone. So. Is the microphone coming around? Yeah.
Things I'm curious about is what has been the role of patient advocacy in pricing and reimbursement? Because one of the reasons why some of these products are so successful is because we have the opportunities to get reimbursed for some of these important drugs.
That's a great question. Everybody here, what is the role of patient advocacy in the area of pricing and reimbursement?
Yeah, I mean, Joan should comment on this. I mean, I think one of the fantastic examples, again, is the CF Foundation, where they have understood the importance of providing economic incentives for innovators to ultimately bring their medicines to patients. And so they've really, I think, had a very good dialogue around how companies should think about pricing and incentives and how that's important ultimately for a pull of attractiveness. And I think they've had the right approach. Michael J. Fox, similar approach in Parkinson's. Again, thinking quite a bit about the importance of having a carrot at the end of the stick to incent companies to ultimately direct their innovation toward the diseases of importance. I mean, Joan, you can speak to it in the CF Foundation specifically, but
right, and I think that's a really difficult issue when you look at Kalydeco, which is so expensive for the people who have it, and certainly the whole idea of the access to care. We do a survey every year among our population, and more than 25% of people are saying that they're skipping medications or delaying medications or skipping doctor's appointments because of cost of care issues. And I think that's one of the things the foundation has done is to make sure that we have, if we can't come to bear on the pricing of a company, have developed resources that can help patients bridge that gap through patient access programs and so on and so forth. But it's a tricky issue. I mean, you have some people who feel that they won the lottery by just having the ability to access those medications that are so life-changing, and then other folks who are sitting on the sidelines still waiting for treatment.
Please, yeah.
I think you asked two separate questions, or at least questions that have two separate types of answers. And that is that insofar as patients being effective in getting reimbursement from insurance companies and Medicare, I think there's been great success. In terms of success in patients reducing cost of medications, there's been far less progress. Now, there has been major progress in emerging economies, poor countries, in reducing the cost of drugs. The cost of an annual cost for AIDS medication in the U.S. is about $8,000, and it's about $80 many countries. And that's true for a wide variety of medications. So that is a different kind of patient advocacy. It's on a global level where it's been very effective. I think we now have a two-tiered system which may be applicable to many drugs. But in terms of our country and the way we price drugs, you may be surprised to know that Medicare is forbidden by law to negotiate price. So there's much less progress there, and I think it is a big area for exploration. And I would add another area, and it may not be popular amongst many biotech executives, but the whole bioequivalence issue. The industry that's managed to keep prices very, very high on bioequivalence has not been successful in many other countries. It is successful here, but I think that's one example where patient advocates may be able to make some real progress in reducing the cost of these, some of these very expensive medications, which are now off patent. And you could argue the companies have been well recompensed for their efforts. So I think that's an area to target in the future.
So, as you said, important area, and as a biotech executive, as Bill said,
but it's a big issue that
absolutely a big issue, and I think it's a great question, and the worst thing about this question is when it goes unasked. And I think, you know, the role of patient advocacy and the like is to host this discussion. And that is the most important thing. Now, people won't always agree on it, but I guarantee you we will all agree on the basic elements. We may not agree where Kalydeco should be priced or some other specific drug exactly, but the elements are the same. And one of the most important elements here is the model. And the number of medications that are available today that are transforming lives because the model, in other words, there was a business model that said, if I invest now, I will be able to get a return. That is the most sacred thing that we have. Now, it cannot be abused. The other part of your question was, how do I advocate for access? And as Joan said, you know, patients are missing doses, skipping appointments. We live in a world of rare diseases where I don't even know I have the disease. I don't even know that I should be going to a doctor. I don't even know there's a medication that I could be missing. And so thinking holistically as a patient advocate is incredibly valuable. And this is where this dialogue, the fact of life about a lot of these questions is there will be no right answer. But the ability to have the discussion, to have the honest debate, is going to get us to the best possible outcome at that moment. And so, again, that is a role of patient advocacy. And I think I'm going to answer my own question earlier, this question of the balance of emotion and knowledge. We need both, right? We can't just have raw emotion, you know, overriding the FDA or, you know, driving a research agenda. On the other hand, we can't have a research agenda that isn't being pushed by a mother with a child who says, my child's going to die anymore, and it's just unacceptable that you're not getting there. So there's a balance in all these elements that is extremely important. So,
David, I think the simple way to call it is we have to be passionately informed.
Passionately informed. Perfect. So we'll work down first, and then Victor, and then Jim.
Does any of the panel have a comment on whether the press is totally silent in all of this? Are they an actor in this discussion, or are they irrelevant?
I think the media has been pretty, I think the media is involved in this discussion pretty actively, as they should be. I think there are aspects of it that they do cover. We can debate whether this is covered well or whether it's covered just to create a story. I think there's a little bit of both out there, but they're certainly involved, for sure.
As we all know, the media is a mixed bag. It covers many sides of the issues. Some of them, depending where you stand, it gets right. Some of them, where you stand, it may get wrong. But one of the things I've been impressed with over the years is how professional some of the health reporters are. There's a very well-educated cadre of reporters that cover our field that are very responsible. I can think of people like Andrew Pollack, for example, would be a good example. But there are many, many others that cover these. Sometimes in the... maybe especially the televisions need to have faces to problems, you get more of the emotional side than you get of the rational side. But I think on the whole, it's certainly an active participant, and I think it's an important tool for the patient advocacy groups to work with to affect their ends.
One of the most powerful, I mean, the debates, they may be accurately informed or not accurately informed, but the stories that are told in the media, I mean, the media can give the story a life, the patient's history, their experience a life that doesn't come through in many other places. And it's not that should trump its emotional, part of the component, the story or the situation to a certain extent, but it's a critical element. And so again, media, I think, has a big role to play to make sure that we don't forget what is at stake here, wherever you sit.
I think there are certain organizations, and I would point out the Wall Street Journal in particular, that has had a history, maybe not a recent history, of being a opponent of the FDA. They have attacked the FDA over and over and over again. Now, one of the issues they attacked it on is a company that I helped found, which is now called Dendrion. And you might remember the series of, it was a real campaign against the FDA. I think that's misplaced. I think the demonization in the press, at least some parts of the press, of the FDA is really misplaced. Maybe we don't always agree with them, but when you work with the FDA, at least in my experience, over a long period of time, you come to realize that they're trying to do the same thing that you are trying to do. They may come at it from a different perspective. They may have other requirements and other pressures than our pressures. In fact, they're quite different. But in the end, my experience with them is that they are responsive, they are helpful, and they do their best to do their job in a conscientious way. And it might be part of our responsibility and patient advocacy responsibility to mitigate some of the, what I think are unfounded attacks on the FDA by the press.
Jim?
Thank you. I want to go back to the Josh Hardy case, Chimerix case, because I think that it's probably an inflection point. Here we had Fox Television, we had Facebook, we had Twitter generating literally hundreds of thousands of calls. We had death threats on the CEO of the company and his family. He's no longer with the company, largely as a result of this. And I don't think that's going to change. The little boy's life was saved, and it appears. And that's a model that's going to be replicated. It makes great media. It's going to encourage other families to do this, and I think if there is a crescendo of this kind of activity, it's going to call for some kind of similar change in the system, because it's untenable to have a CEO in the position, because all of those thousands of tweeters, et cetera, were passionate and emotional, but none of them had any idea what compassionate use is and what the company was up against. And so it begs the question, I'd like to posed to the panel, and that is, do we need another way of doing this so that someone other than the company do we need a mediating force, a group of ethicists or others who can say yes or no, we recommend it, or at least we recommend it, we don't recommend, because otherwise I think, as I said, the CEO in the company is in an untenable position, and it once again portrays the industry as it ultimately, as negative as the industry was portrayed in, for instance, the Dallas Buyers Club.
So I've had to say no to compassionate use, okay? And it's unbelievably painful to do it, especially when it's somebody who you know, who's contacting you, and they're asking on behalf of a friend, a family member, whoever the case might be, if they can get access to a drug that you have the control to offer that drug or not to offer that drug. It's incredibly difficult, and the reasons that oftentimes it doesn't happen, we've done it on other occasions, is that first and foremost, there may not be enough evidence based on what you know of your drug or on the safety of the product, and you realize that you're on very thin ice to allow the use of the drug in an uncontrolled setting where the drug safety has not been adequately proven, and that effectively you can do more harm by making the drug available by, you know, allowing the compassionate use, especially when it's outside of a protocol, it's outside of a trained, you know, user of the drug, and you have to do something which may be for the benefit of that patient, but certainly may be for the benefit of the other hundreds of patients that might benefit when your drug is proven to be safe and effective, to say no. I do think, and Jim, we've talked about this recently, I do think that one thing that could be done is there could be policies, regulatory policies, where there are safe harbors around potential adverse events that would be incurred upon use of a drug in a compassionate protocol that, frankly, would change the concern that many drug developers have, that if I offered the drug for compassionate use, that God forbid something bad happens to the patient, obviously typically very high risk situations, where that might have create a situation where your drug is put on clinical hold or whatever the case might be, which for small companies can be a fatal event, okay? So there are things that could be considered along those lines, but I think moreover, there needs to be a dialogue around what are the standards that we all think collectively, and it's always going to be case by case based on the indication, but there ought to be a set of standards that are considered for what constitutes safety, what constitutes sufficient level of clinical activity that would warrant consideration of a compassionate use.
The only comes in, right?
Yeah.
We're talking about history. Compound Q is a very good case study that is not very well known. I don't know if many of you noticed in Dallas Buyers Club, but there was a box of Compound Q there, which I remember because I was involved in that. What?
I remember too. Yeah.
Right, it was there, and it was one of his medications, and it killed people. I'm pretty sure it killed people. I mean, everybody who took it in the doses that they gave died quickly, and that is a very good lesson. But I think in answer to your question, we need both liability protection, if we're going to do compassionate use, and regulatory protection from the FDA. Because if you're a CEO, you are terrified, and your investors are beating on you. Do not take a risk. If you do that, I'm sure that CEO was being pounded on by his board and by his investors. Don't take this risk, because you're going to threaten the whole program. The FDA is going to check out your whole program, and all the money we've invested is going down the drain. So you're right. We need, if we're going to have compassionate use on a systematic basis, we need both kinds of protection. And we need a very good education system that says, if you take this drug, you may die tomorrow, for sure, or you may die from this drug. Today, you may kill your kid by giving him this drug, because we don't know if it's safe. You have to have very explicit, brutal language. You've got to have protection. So I think you've asked a great question. And it's something that I think the biotechnology community and pharmaceutical industry can make some difference.
Can I just, I agree, but with a slight variation here. I think the FDA can do more to help us think this through. It will never be the FDA's decision, and it will always be case by case. So those of us in the industry holding that card will never get relief from having to make that individual decision. Now, I'll give you one example from our world. You know, this was outside the U.S., but we had a drug that was going through development, and we had patients who chained themselves to a fence to get, you know, access to the drug. Highly visible, of course, on the media, tremendous amount of pressure from within the country. That case needed to be dealt with individually. What really helped was not how we dealt with that case, but the role of the patient organization in helping us think through the larger, you know, how do we do this? Because we couldn't have everybody chaining themselves to the fence. That's the point, right? I mean, you, in making the exception that you want to make, I mean, you desperately want to, I mean, it's not that patient. The problem is not giving that, and I don't actually think the fear of liability, the fear of screwing up the trial, it all can be explained in a way. I don't think the risk to our programs is as great as sometimes we portray it, but what is a risk is the next case, and the next case, and the next case. And so there, you need the patient organizations to rally together to bring some sanity to this. Now, to help them help us, that's where, you know, getting everybody at the table and saying, look, this is where we are. This is everything we know. This is what's at stake. This is what happens if the next patient chains themselves or the next patient chains themselves. So patient advocacy have an unbelievably important role in bringing sanity to this. They'll never make the John's decision easier. That's going to be John's always. But they can help us manage the next case and the bigger problem. So we are at 7 o'clock. I thank everybody for joining. I thank our panel members for a great discussion, and it will go on. Thank you.